Was the sleep or he did, was the sleep or a joke? Okay. All right. So I guess my title was about truthfulness, approximation, and mechanism design. But so let me start with something that is probably familiar to all of you, the Vickrey auction. Or second price auction, which is in some sense the oldest, cheapest trick in mechanism design, is the following idea. And again, it's good to start from something which everybody is familiar with. In order to auction a single item, like a Chinese vase, you show it to people until everybody forms in their mind that's actually an important assumption that is not very credible. You know, that everybody has a particular real number in their mind, okay, which is how much this, how many dollars this Chinese vase is worth to them. And then you go through the following mechanism, the following protocol. You ask for sealed bids, and then you open them and you give the Chinese vase to the person who bid the highest, and you charge them an amount equal to the second highest bid, not what they bid, but the second highest bid. All right? And this, it's sort of a simple proof that because of this stratagem, it's to your best interest to reveal this real number. This real number is private, okay? It's your own secret. You will not, since you are out, you are a super rational agent out there to leave the room with as much utility as possible, okay? You don't want to share this with anybody because you don't want them to know how much this Chinese vase is worth to you. But because the protocol is this, it turns out there is a simple mathematical proof that it's to your best interest not to lie high, because if you lie high, you run the risk of paying more money that the Chinese vase is worth, okay? And not to lie low, because you will not gain anything, because the second bid rule shields you from below, and you are just lying. You are running a risk of underbidding the second bidder, and therefore losing the item. Okay, so that's simple proof. You know, nothing else makes sense. So the Vickrey auction is great because of two things. First of all, it maximizes social welfare by this we mean that the total utility of every participant, if you add the utilities of the participant in the end if you add the utilities, or you know the pure utilities, forget payments. Payments stay within the family, okay? So you know, but if you add the utilities of the participants at the end of the auction, what will happen is that it will be lots of zeros and one value. But the point is that among all possible outcomes, the best outcome in terms of this sum is what happened. Okay, so this little trick maximizes social welfare, and also achieves another goal, which is unclear if it's a goal or a means. Okay, called truthfulness, that it encourages everybody to tell the truth, all right? And incidentally, one thing that I want to point out in the beginning is that truthfulness is no loss of generality. Uh, Truthfulness, in some sense, is a mathematical means, okay? Because unless you have a way to make your mechanism truthful, it becomes too messy, okay? Sort of, you know, there is very, very hard to do mathematics about speculation and scheming, okay? So, definitely, yes. I mean, right. And in fact, I'm going to talk about that. But so it's a mathematically clean assumption, sort of, you know. And the point is, the amazing thing is that it's not a loss of generality, okay? You can assume without a loss of generality that it's truthful. And here is the argument that powerful argument that works in most situations. Imagine that you have a mechanism that is not truthful, that basically it's an invitation for you to lie, okay? So somebody has their data. There are many agents here with their data, and they're going to lie. And now somebody comes and says, "Listen, why don't you hire a professional liar to lie for you? Okay, tell him the truth, and he will lie for you. Okay, he will do the best thing. Okay, he's a professional. And the same for this guy. Okay, and everybody else." And now the idea is that this thing here, if you incorporate the professional liars with the mechanism, is another mechanism, M prime, which is truthful. Okay. And this is a powerful argument. This simple argument is powerful enough that sort of convinces you that it's called the revelation principle, that in many contexts you can assume truthfulness. I mean, the only context, by the way, where, you know, one of the rare contexts where this may not be true is the case, and this has not been explored. This is a complex theoretic situation where this communication is complex. Okay, so and therefore it could be that that the optimal mechanism, if you wish, may not be truthful. So the first price auction is sort of, you know, is the auction you all know, and indeed, as Avi said, it does invite you to lie. Now, how you lie is complicated. Okay, so you know, it assumes that everyone has a prior about the distribution of everybody else, and then they calculate their optimum bid in terms of that and so on. Okay, so but I mean, you know, I see. So would you get in this case? Yes, you would get. I guess. You get this. I mean, although you cannot get anything else. You will get this. Yes,
it's
right.
It's not clear even that the revelation principle will get you something that maximizes social welfare.
It does in the following sense. Okay, that what we are saying is that. Okay, I see what you are saying. All right. Okay. Yes. Okay. True. I take it back. Right. Okay. So there are too many scenarios here, right? I mean, so I am designing this mechanism because I want to maximize, let's say, social welfare, right? I mean, so if I, you know, and what I'm saying is that that this mechanism can be replaced by mechanism M prime, in which you always tell the truth. Okay, you know, M is designed with your lies to maximize social welfare, right? And if this is, you know, then M would probably not be the first price auction, all right? Okay, so I guess that's you know, cool, yeah. Okay, so truthfulness, in some sense, is a very, you know, It is everywhere in mechanism design in this field. Why are computer scientists interested in this? Okay, and there is one extreme way of seeing why I am interested in this is the following, right? That mechanism designs are a new kind of algorithm, right? Are a new kind of algorithm that are it's relevant to what's happening in the world around us now. Okay, so let's say to the internet. Okay, in the following sense, the Vickrey auction, okay, is an algorithm. You can see it as an auction, or you can see it as an algorithm that as the new Max algorithm. Okay, so remember, most of you, the young generation, your first program you wrote was Hello World, okay? So, but for me, my first program was this, okay? Max equals zero, for I equals one to n, if Max is less than A of I, then Max equals A of I. Okay, I hope I remember it correctly. Okay, so this finds you the max of n elements. Okay, so you can see the Vickrey auction as the new max algorithm. Okay, it's an algorithm that compels your inputs, okay, to be true. Okay, it provides in some sense. Computing in the new environment, okay, where your inputs are controlled by somebody else, right? So it could be seen as the creation of a mechanism, okay? So where you have to bribe or incentivize your inputs to not to lie through their teeth, okay? So this is one reason why I'm interested in this, okay? And the point is, in this new environment, it turns out that things don't change much. And I'm going to say this, to state this immediately. If you wish, P stays the same, okay? If you can do it in polynomial time, you can still do it in polynomial time. All right, and I'm going to show you the general reduction that does this next. If it's NP-complete, by virtue of the fact that the inputs can lie, that does make it easier, okay? And there is one mystery, okay? So it's everything, whether APX intersect NP-complete stays the same. All right, so in other words, or if you wish, is there a three-way conflict between truthfulness, polynomial time, and approximability? Is there a three-way clash there, okay? And it turns out that we know well that two of these can be handled, any two of these. But not all three. That's the result that I'm going to show you. All right.
Talk about all three, because with that complete, if the input lies, it makes the problem harder. It's not clear they stay in NP.
Right. Yes. But but it stays in NP. Yeah. So the reduction that shows that P is preserved also works for NP-complete problems. Okay. So this is the first part of my talk. In the second part of my talk, if there is time, I want to talk about something else. I'm going to talk about another great work about auctions. So that's one. And the second part of my talk will be about complexity in Meyerson's auction. So imagine that, I mean, so this is a specialized enough context for auctions. There is a different kind of auctions in which, let's say, the Meyerson environment, where you have much more information. You have prior distributions for the valuation of every individual, and you have an auctioneer who is eager to maximize their revenue, not social welfare. All right, so that's a beautiful problem. Meyerson in 1980 gave an exquisite solution to that problem. Okay, it's a beautiful like design problem, engineering problem, if you wish. And Meyerson did a very sophisticated, mathematically very sophisticated analysis of it and came up with a beautiful solution. The solution, and then science stopped in some sense, or, you know, there were very few steps again after that, okay? And in particular, Meyerson solved the case where the agents were statistically independent, probabilistically independent, and there was very little known about the dependent, the correlated case, okay? And there is a very nice complexity analysis that shows why, okay? And I'm going to finish with that. All right. So, but let's go back to our this auction. So, now I'm going to tell you about the general situation, the general context, and basically what you have. What is a mechanism design? You have a possible set of utilities U, okay? Usually it's the sum R plus to the N, okay? A general set of utilities, and you have a set of alternatives. So these utilities are basically how a bunch of agents, N agents, I guess we start with N, evaluate this set of alternatives, all right? Typically it's going to be finite. For example, to give you, you know, in the Vickrey auction, the set of alternatives is the set 1, 2, 3 up to n, okay? Because these are the outcomes. One gets it, two gets it, three gets it, or n gets it, okay? And then we want to design a mechanism, right? So what is U? U is a subset of the functions from A to R. Okay, some subset. And there will be, most of the time will be isomorphic, let's say R plus. Isomorphic to some power, some vector space. And we want to find from this situation, we want to create a mechanism. And mechanism, you could think of it as a game in which the strategy space is, in a telling way, in a suggestive way, identical to the utilities, okay? Meaning that the strategy, you know, every agent does is chooses a utility, and declares this utility. Okay, that has no meaning, has no semantics at this point. You know, it could be some kind of message, some kind of encrypted message that the agent transmits. And from each one of these choices, there is, as a result of one of these choices, one of the outcomes is chosen, okay? And payments are chosen, okay? So how much the agents will pay or will get paid, okay, if this is negative. Okay. This is already a special form called quasi-linear form, which has a pure outcome component and a pure payment component. And in some sense, this is the paradise of mechanism design, because outside it, all bets are off. Okay, there is the, there are impossibility theorems like the Gibbard Satterwhite theorem that says that if you are not, in some sense it's the lamppost in mechanism design. Okay, and we have been looking under this lamppost forever. Okay. So this is what agents choose. This is what happens, and this is what the agents pay. And truthfulness. In this particular situation, there is a wonderful general idea, and it's called the VCG algorithm, out of Vickrey, Clark, and Groves, Vickrey came up with the auction. As I understand this history, Groves generalized it to this more general, and Clark came up with a particular elegant solution of for payments. The mechanism is the following. So I have to do two things. Tell you how to choose this, and choose the argmax over A of the sum over all I of what they declared. Let's call this V hat sub I. Okay. Okay. So basically, these agents chose a particular element of U, and each one of them, and as a result revealed how to evaluate all of the elements of A, and therefore we can now find the social optimum. Okay, this enables us to find the social optimum. And hat means that this is what they did, and God knows if it's the truth. This is what they said, and who knows if it's the truth. And so that's the A part. And I pays P sub I, which is, okay, I will explain. Let's call this opt. Okay, so here is what the ith agent pays. They pay this formula. Okay, these are all hats, which is the following. Therefore, can be computed from the statements. And let's try to parse it. It is this is how much. Imagine that I was not present. Okay. How well off the society would be. Okay, the society now are everybody except for I. Okay, and this is how much. What is the best possible, the social optimum in the absence of I?
It's not R. It's just max, right?
Max. Max. Yes. Right. Right. Sorry. Plus max. Yes. Right. Yeah. True. Yeah. So this is how much this would get, and now this is how much the same people get now that I is there. So in other words, the payment of I is precisely the harm that I is causing the others by virtue of being present. Okay, and the magic of this is called Clark's pivot rule. The magic of this is the following, that now, if you calculate the utility of I, this is going to be what he declared, what his true value, let's say, minus this. Therefore, it's going to be plus this, and therefore, it's going to suddenly this is going to become right. So now imagine that you are I, okay, and now this holds for everybody. You look at this and you say the following. Here is what this is telling me, okay? That what I'm going to pay, I'm sorry, my utility, in other words, how happy I'm going to be at the end of this exercise, is going to be equal to something that does not depend on what I'm saying, what I'm going to say, right? Because this is what would happen if I'm not here. So I don't care about this. So let's concentrate on this, all right? And now, how big can this be, okay? The answer is that it attains its maximum value when everybody tells the truth, all right? And this holds for everybody, right? It attains the maximum when everybody tells the truth and therefore enables the mechanism design to find the true social optimum. So in other words, since what this payment does, it aligns the interests, the incentives of every player with society, okay? Every player now is a self, you know, every bloodsucker is now a selfless patriot, okay? So, you know, who wants society to fare as well as possible, okay? And so this is the effect of this incentive, okay? And this means that the only reasonable thing for everybody to do is to say that. So this is a general way of handling more or less every situation which is of this form. Okay? Yeah.
This is. I mean, one can imagine if you didn't care about social welfare, one can imagine any pricing mechanism that just depended on the other.
True. Yes. This has, precisely. Any pricing mechanism which of this sort, yes, right, yeah. And this particular, you know, it has this intuitive interpretation, plus, so you can add any term to this that does depend, yeah, so, but this has this intuitive interpretation, plus it has some other side effects, okay? For example, it results in auctions where you never pay, you know, participants. Okay, so and so on. I mean, so it enforces a few other things. Okay, so it's the golden standard. Okay, so. Okay, all right. So what I'm saying is, you can see this. So let me give you an example. Okay, I told you about the new Max algorithm. Let's talk about the new Dijkstra's algorithm. Right. So imagine that you have a shortest path problem. Okay, you want to find, you know, the idea is that you want to send a packet from S to T. Okay, so you know, if you are not impressed with the problem, you know, you want to send a petabyte from S to T. Okay. And you have these ISPs in the middle. The edges are individual networks, okay? And basically, these are their true costs, okay? How much energy they are going to consume in order for this to go through, all right? And basically, how much is going to cost them? The point is, how do you find out the truth? Because if you ask how much would it cost you to take a petabyte from here to there, say, oh, it's going to be very expensive. Okay, so you know, no, it's not going to tell the truth. Okay, because it tries to extract. So here's a way to do it. VCG. What basically you promise is the following. Listen, guys, give me your costs, and here is what everybody's going to pay. Everybody's going to pay it. What they tell me, so in other words, the payment is going to be negative because I'm going to pay now the people, right? Everybody's going to get what they tell me, plus a bonus equal to the amount by which the world is a better place by virtue of you being here. Okay? So, this person here is going to get what? He's going to get, if this guy was not here, the shortest path would not be 6, but 7. So he was going to get 1, because the world, sorry? 7, right? Yeah. So the point is that this guy is going to get an extra plus of 1, right? And this guy is going to get an extra of 1 again, right? And this 2. Why? Because, I think, right? Because. So you announce this, and everybody thinks and says, okay, I have to tell the truth. Because it's not in your interest to lie, it's not in their interest to lie low. Right? So in some sense, this is the shortest, the new shortest path algorithm. Okay? You know, the amazing thing is that if you run this on the internet, okay, you cannot know what's happening with payments in the internet, okay? But basically you can calculate if this was happening in the internet, okay? How much overpayment would there be? Okay, and the answer, and experiments show that it's 3%, and the theory
what
says
3%?
It's 3% overpayment.
No, what is
the what is 3%? Okay, so imagine that every edge in the internet, every edge in the router graph.
Oh.
Okay, right, yeah, okay. And then you do the theory, and assuming that the internet is a random graph of some sort, and it comes down to something like over log, 1 over log n, which again is 3%, okay, so that's, all right, so.
So this is not the new shortest path, it's the new data collection.
Precisely, no, but the way I started is by saying sort of that nowadays, the inputs to your algorithm are not just data bits sitting on an input tape. Okay, they are just skimming agents, right? I mean, who try to extract as much, who are very keenly interested in the outcome of your algorithm. All right. So what you have to incentivize. So that's why I'm saying this is the new shortest path algorithm. Right. Cool.
Now.
So how do you compute this, all right? So how do you compute this? And the answer is you can compute it with n plus 1 Dijkstras, right? I mean, basically you find Dijkstra, it's not n plus 1. And then you repeat Dijkstra for this graph, for this graph, for this graph, okay?
How do you repeat? I mean, the theory will not tell you the truth.
No. You run in your computer now Dijkstra.
But do you know
that?
No, you get their values and then you compute.
So basically what will happen, okay, is you tell me your values, they will tell you the truth, and I'll say sit back and I'll tell you how much you are getting, okay? And you do everything publicly, sort of, and they don't, right? Okay, good. It looks like you have to do it you need a lot of Dijkstra algorithms to do this, okay? But it turns out in this particular case, there is a surprising result due to Hershberger and Suri that you can do it with one run of Dijkstra. Okay, so it's by if you are clever enough in your data structures, right? Unless the graph is directed, in which case, in some sense, you require, in the right model, square root of n runs of Dijkstra. Okay, so it's a fun, but the point is that this is the new Dijkstra, the new shortest path. Fine, but the question is, how about the new TSP? The new traveling says no problem. Okay, or if you wish, combinatorial auctions, which is the new weighted set cover, set packing problem. So, what happens if you have this means that in these NP-complete problems, there is no other way around it. You have to solve many times and then be complete problem, all right? And you can do it, you know, it does become harder. But so it's a general reduction, works for MP-complete problems. And so, sorry?
What works, the same algorithm that you...
Yes.
That's true for all objective functions, not just shortest path?
It's true for all objective functions, yes.
Which, no characterization?
No, you know, so it's let's see.
Function that's sum of edges or something like that?
It doesn't have to, it can be nonlinear functions also. Yeah. So it's this argument, right? I mean, that basically if you can compute this, and you can compute this, and subtract them, that's incentive enough for everybody to give the true value. Okay? So, Right. Yes. Yeah. So, I mean, I never said that this is how that I have an explicit yes. Right. I mean, so of course I'm going to be interested in from now on after the Vickrey auction, I'm going to be interested in auction design where there in mechanism design where there is exponential number of alternatives. All right. Okay. So to make a long story short. Here we celebrate everything, the new P is P. Here we say, okay, I guess I knew that, the new NP complete is still NP complete. And now we say, okay, what did you do last time when you encountered intractability? We resorted to approximation, all right? And now the question is, so the new P, as I said, is, okay, so how about approximation, which is the obvious maneuver. And the tragedy of computational mechanism design is this, that approximation does not mix well with VCG. Okay, that if you substitute here approximate algorithms, suddenly it's not incentive compatible. It's not truthful.
Are you relaxing the notion of truthfulness?
Of?
Are you relaxing truthfulness as well?
Yes, I mean, and imagine that you are willing to relax truthfulness and social optimum, the point is that it's not truthful at all, okay, so that there is a cascade of lies that makes everybody say, in the worst case, garbage, okay, right, so it's not truthful at all. So, it would be great, a great question, it would be fantastic. If we had an example, I don't believe that we have one, where there is epsilon truthfulness. They lie, but they will not lie more than 20%. Okay, so and therefore I can do something. Okay, that'll be fine.
I guess it's the old addition. You never stop
with
just one lie.
Exactly. I guess we have all wonderful. Allusion, yes, right. We have all experienced that, right? Yes, yeah.
Some results of Silvio study with Paul Valiant and Vincent, where you don't care about truthfulness and nevertheless you get very close to the social
open. Yes, right, yes, yes, I should mention that there are a few results. Where you get, you can find auctions. That's for combinatorial auctions. There are some really interesting ways of getting around some of these using randomization and novel kinds of that you can get around in the auction setting, in the combinatorial auction actually setting. These require assumptions about they require assumptions about for the behavior of the for the behavior and interests of the bidders, for example, that they know secrets when a field is stuck, sort of, you know, you have to do strange things, okay? And they do a few clever strange things, okay? Who am I to judge? Okay, so you know, they did the require strange things. Okay, so that's great for them. You know, they are convincing. This is a very convincing work. Okay, so. As I said, approximation is you have terrible news for that. Okay, so let's look back. So in order to investigate this question, okay. In other words, how truthfulness, approximability, and polynomial time interfere. Okay. In order to do this, we must look beyond VCG. And the question is, what lies beyond VCG? Okay. And the short answer. Due to Roberts in the beginning of 80, it's a beautiful theorem called Roberts' theorem. Says in general, more VCG. In other words, there is nothing else. Okay, but in general. Okay, so let me state the theorem. If U is R to the A, in other words, if I assume that my utilities have no special structure whatsoever, but my agents come with arbitrary functions mapping my alternatives to, so that's a very strong assumption, all right? There are more than three alternatives. Then the only truthful mechanisms select essentially the social optimum. They select the maximum, the social optimum, with some weights, some positive or negative weights, and also some particular solutions get a premium, okay, which is arbitrary. They select this max, and then A has to be some subset of. In other words, they all. Pick a subset of the alternatives. Some alternatives become impossible because of truthfulness. All right, so you rule out some alternatives, and then you say find a social optimum. Okay, so in other words, it says that's what I said. In general,
and then give according to this the VCG.
And then payments could be yes. Why not? Yes, right. Yeah. I mean, then it becomes a problem that you don't have to solve. Yes, right, exactly. Yeah. So, but basically, that's a very disappointing result. It says that in this general, thank God, this is a very weak assumption. This is a very strong assumption, right? I mean, it says that you know absolutely nothing about your agents, all right? And we'll come back to that. Okay. Now.
Norm and some of his students relax the assumptions.
So there has been. You know, there are in the last 30 years, the last, you know, has been some work on this, and most of them is due to Nissen and Wallen. They have been trying to basically have a general, more general characterization when U is not this. Okay, first of all, they found out that for it doesn't hold for combinatorial auctions, which was their main interest. Okay, so it fails for combinatorial auctions. You can do other things. Okay, so because you see, if you want to find, this is a very useful result if you want to prove lower bounds. Okay, it says here is all your solutions. All right, you know every complex theorist dreams of a result like that. I mean, it says now you have to deal with a bunch of combinatorial objects. Okay, nothing else. But unfortunately, for most contexts, it doesn't hold. All right, so okay, yeah. Oh yes, of course. So that's another. I mean, so far we have been required our algorithms to be here. Of course, no, right? Because you have fine deterministic solutions. Okay, but who knows? In more general, yes, it could be, right? I mean, so and the result. And, you know, there are. I'm going to show you in the second part. Situations where randomness really gains you a lot. Okay. So now I want to completely change the subject and talk about a problem in the internet. So here's a problem called.
One more question.
Yeah.
What if you require the sum of the payments to be zero?
So there is no transfers. You can always achieve that. Sorry. You know, the payments are. I see. You mean you don't count the mechanism. Okay, you don't count the payments of the mechanism.
No. So there are payments, but in this case, there, you know, the sum may not be zero.
Right.
So the money has to be paid.
Right. So let me tell you how classical mechanism design dealt with this problem. All right. I mean, basically. First of all, it was the only lamppost we had. Okay. But I mean, the other thing they said was, listen, okay, this is, I mean, imagine that you are a government, sort of, you know, trying to find the best way to go, okay? Then, okay, you pay something, who cares? So, you know, it stays in the family, so, you know, the nation does well, okay? So that's, yeah.
By the way, I mean, this kind of method, I mean, the story with this, like the network and so on, I mean, usually utilities are price setters.
They don't?
Yeah. I mean,
they don't?
They don't accept what you pay them, you know? Like, it's more that they are price setters, right? There's this distinction.
They don't, like, accept.
Meaning, you know, you can't just decide that this is what I'm going to pay. It doesn't go with the story.
Right. Yes, I know. No, true, yes, right. I mean, no, but imagine a situation where I want to, you know, I'm the government. I want to move sort of, you know, all astronomical data from the East Coast to the West Coast, you know, and you know, what do you do?
You're a large customer, and therefore you have price.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So here is another internet story. Imagine that you have a network, sort of a bunch of. Nodes who won't communicate with each other, and now the following interesting thing happens: you look at your routing tables. In other words, how much delay, let's say, do I have from here to there? Okay, and you get a distance matrix, and it's not a metric. Okay, it's not because these are brain dead machines that do this. Okay, you might be distressed because you send something from, you want to send something from here to there, and it goes through the whole network. Okay, so that's and you want to find a better way, and one better way is the following: you create an overlay network, okay, which basically you choose carefully a few nodes, all right, in the network, which are very nicely connected with each other, okay, and they're very nicely located, and you say, all right, guys. You always, you know, this is a fine network, And if you want to send from here to there, you do this, okay? You find your closest overlay and you go there, and then the overlay knows how to route and you go to the, okay, this happens, okay? This is you know, both providers and companies and individuals do that. And now you have an interesting problem, right? How do you choose the overlay, right? First of all, imagine that you know how many overlay nodes you want, okay? And what do you want? You want to maximize the total, okay? So you know, you may have the total improvement in the distance metrics by an overlay. Okay? So you want to find k nodes, let's say 3 or 4, such that if you make them and then you have this protocol, you go to your nearest overlay, the distance metrics overall as a sum is decreased as much as possible, right? And now this turns out to be a submodular, it's a submodular function.
How do you compute the distance in the overlay, or it's just nothing?
The distance of the overlay is basically the original distance in the overlay. Or it is the shortest path distance, in the matrix, I'm not sure which of the two works, okay? Either you leave it, I forget if you leave it alone, or you optimize it. You make it into a metric, okay?
But then I don't see how can the distance decrease.
Oh, it decreases because these were arbitrary numbers, okay? To go from here to there, I could have gone this way. They're not a metric. They're not a metric. They're arbitrary numbers. So it's an arbitrary matrix, okay?
Ah, okay.
Okay, of huge positive numbers, or you know that, okay. And now you choose a few good ones, a good sum matrix. You want to choose a good sum matrix so that if you compute the distances through this intermediate matrix, you get as good. Right. Yeah, exactly. So you want to avoid the biggest mistakes, okay? So you know, you want to, right.
So to get from a node outside the overlay to the overlay is still the cost that.
Right. Yeah.
Now the within the overlay, is it
distance? Let's say I forget what's the right. Either you leave it as it is, or you compute the optimum distance. I think both work, but I'm not sure. Okay. And now it's an optimization problem, all right? You have to find max over all overlays which have cardinality k of the sum of the dij's of O. Okay, of this overlay. Okay, as dij is as they are modified by this submatrix. Okay, and that's an interesting problem. Okay, so you know. Sorry. Yes. Yeah. Or, in fact, you want to maximize the improvement. Okay, so I guess that's what I had in mind. All right, but let's leave it this way. The point is that. I guess I want to put it the other way. You want to maximize the sum of the dij before minus, okay? You want to maximize that, the improvement. And it turns out that this is an interesting problem. It's NP-complete, of course, and all that. Except that it gives you sort of, it's a new kind of problem which we called the combinatorial public project problem. Okay, so basically you have a lot of people who are interested in building something. Okay, and each one has its own way to evaluate it. All right, and what you want to do is you want to maximize overall, sets that have k, the max of the sum overall principles overall agents I of some function, some value, the way of evaluating S. All right? And the combinatorial public projects problem, it has my co-authors. This is, by the way, joint work with Michael Shapira and Yaron Singer. So my co-authors think of it as electing kibbutz committees, okay? You have to find K people, sort of, you know, who maximize the community's value of this committee, okay? So,
what is it? What's new I of S?
VI of S is the value to each particular element of the community. Right. If you wish, over here you can see the total distance to all other nodes, okay? All right? So the improvement in the total distance overall.
Then to complete if S is, if K is large, then
it's epicomplete if K is large enough, yes, right.
But if K is large, how do you specify these functions? I mean, how are the functions specified?
So we are going to talk a lot about specifying the functions, okay? So our intention is that they're specified in some succinct way. All right? Cool. All right. So, this is our assumption is that VI is submodular, which turns out to be true in this example. And as a result, you have an approximation, okay? There is, you can be approximated within 63%, okay? It's a very well-known old result, sort of, you know, due to Nemhauser and co-authors, that this can be done, that some modular functions can be optimized, can be approximated by the greedy algorithm okay? So, and this is the specimen which you are going to use in order to reveal this problem here. Okay?
Just a question about this. If we forgot polynomial time, just had the approximability and truthfulness.
Yeah. Approximability and truthfulness. Yes, you can approximate, you can actually solve the exact problem. Right? If not without polynomial, you can run n minus one. You can run a lot of exponential algorithms, find the optimum. And that's approximation enough. You can find the optimum without if you don't care about polynomial time. You can run VCG, and this will give you the optimum. So you are saying that this diagram lies a little, sort of, you know, that the
you're forced into approximation for some other reason, because let's say this, some values are given to you. I mean, things that you need to compute are inherently inaccessible. So I mean, if the reason for needing approximability is information theory. Maybe there is no example.
Yeah, you know, I cannot think of an example. Yeah. Okay, and here is sort of so we really so you know here is our really huge lucky break. Okay, we proved that that Robert's theorem holds. Even for n equals 2, actually. If you have just two members, the society consists just of two, and you want to compute, or if you wish, if there are only two different valuations, then this theorem that as I said, is every complexity theorist's dream lemma. When they start analyzing something, turns out to be true. How do we know? the not Roberts's proof, but Nissan and Moalen's proof. If you carefully, you know, all steps go through. Okay.
Where is the modulus of modularity?
It's not something. It's not used, but since we want to do this for this, we make sure that these are some modular. We make sure that the functions. So basically, to prove that this lemma, you have to hit. You have to hit the mechanism with functions. Okay. We make sure that all functions you hit it with are submodular.
I'm not sure that I understand this new lemma.
Okay, so it says that if the space of your utility are sums of submodular functions, okay, are submodular functions like here, then the only truthful mechanisms are going to be like this. Right. Yeah. So what I'm saying is that Roberts, the way he gets this is he assumes a mechanism and then starts hitting it with strange utility functions. What I'm saying is that you can do this by hitting it with submodular utility functions. Yeah. Okay. And you cannot do it by hitting it with combinatorial options. Okay. Okay. So that's important, a very important way to start with. And now comes the first complexity result.
So what's n in this?
N is the number of agents. Okay, so you can it's not the number of, so you think of this set as resources. Okay, you.
K is 1 or 2.
No. K is huge.
Okay.
Okay, but the sum is taken over two things. Okay. Right, yeah, there's a larger universe of resources, underlying universe of resources, yeah. Typically, there are m resources and k will be square root of m. Okay, this is the universe we're going to be working on. Okay, and now comes, so that was a really lucky break. So let me give, from this, you can have a lemma 2, which says that, for this problem, if an algorithm like this achieves approximation ratio of approximation of all right, so. What is m? M is the number of resources. K equals square root of m is the cardinality of the solutions we are looking for. If there is a subset of all the k subsets of m that achieves large enough, almost more than square root of m ratio, then the context, of course, is this problem. Then this has to be exponential. So basically, this proves that if your approximation is anything less than ridiculous, okay, which is right, then you must have an exponential number of sets. And this is everybody's following? That we have, let's say, two agents and many resources. We are interested in finding for some modular VI the maximum of this thing. Okay, we know that anything that is truthful
So is the setup is that even though the VI is, we don't know the two VIs.
We don't know the two VIs.
But they tell a VI or they just, so I mean, what do we know?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, what do we know? We are interested in truthfulness, okay? That's number one. We are interested in good approximation, okay?
Yeah, but the model is that they reveal the value for a particular S, or they, I mean,
No.
They reveal the whole function?
So they reveal, let's say, the whole function. Yes, right, yeah. Okay, in the beginning of the
sum, right. Or
yeah, or, yeah.
Like,
so, right, I mean, also it depends, you know, if you know, it depends on the context, okay? So, you know, it could be a context where you have communication, you know, that the data is exponential, okay? So, you know, we are only interested in the case where the data is polynomial, okay? If the data is exponential, I'll show you there is a way to prove that you are hopeless. So you have to ship all the data across. Okay, you know, but the main result here is that you can do it, you can connect this to P versus NP. Okay, not with communication complexity. Okay.
Back to obviously. So the point there was that one can hope that this linear function has small support, and then you need to check only few alternatives.
Right.
Initially, it could have been that A prime.
Right. Very sparse set of solutions, and this is enough to give you. Okay, and I'm saying no. If you are ambitious, then and the proof of this is really simple. Okay, so let me tell you. Let me sketch it to you. Sort of. You know.
Can I ask something?
Is it obvious that what's M over K? So yes, in this, what am I saying here? So it's not obvious, but you can. Yeah, you can. You know, in all of this context, you can find the square root of M approximation. You can definitely do it in combinatorial auctions. I think we say in our paper that you can do it, and you have a, you know. I see.
Somebody who, which strangely maximizes submodular functions, but I don't remember.
I see.
Approximately. But
I see.
So
what they show is that you can do it with one over E. That the greedy algorithm does it. Yeah, I know maximizing some modular function is not right. Yeah.
Wouldn't just picking a one element set give you one over K? Because
right. Yeah. So there is something as simple as that. Yes. Right. I mean, that starting the greedy algorithm sort of, you know, you know, just optimizing over only one element set, so you know, would give you something. So there is, I think there is a trivial square root of M algorithm. And this shows that there can be nothing better. And the proof is quite simple. What you do is you create a particular function. I mean, this is holds even for one element, for one agent. So basically, you create V of S. V of a particular, the evaluation is S intersect V. And what is V? V is where V is sampled with probability. Exactly this, yeah. All right? End of essentially, you know, basically what it shows is that so what's going to happen? If you sample with this probability, okay, then what's the chance that you are going to have more than square root of M So, okay. So, what am I saying? That the optimum is going to be about square root of m. All right. So you sample from m elements something with this probability. So the optimum is going to be about m to the 1/2 plus epsilon. Okay. And now, if you know, how many sets do you need? How many sets do you need in order to be sure that it hits a randomly chosen this probability set? Enough. Okay. More than. And the answer is you need an exponential number of by the union bound. Okay. So that's you need. Sorry?
How do you access B? How is B specified? How is the valuation
function? So in this case, you just give the capital V. Yeah. In this case, you could give a the vector of all yeah. Okay. You need exponential in m to the epsilon. Sets to intersect seriously. This means more than m to the epsilon v, a random v. Let's say we have one player. Or they all have the same valuation. We have n players, they all have the same valuation.
Which is this random function.
This random function. Okay, now your job is the following, okay? You are given this stupid A prime, okay? Okay? And somebody samples things, okay? The maximum intersection, okay, of anything with any set in A prime is going to be small. Unless A prime is really huge. It's exponential.
So, Christos, what you're saying is there's a family of inputs. So that if you want to do well on these inputs, your space of solution should be reasonably large, very large.
Yeah.
So you think of that. That formula there, that it's the maximum of the...
Right.
So, suppose it's given by this.
This?
No, Robert's formula, no?
Right, yes, of course, yes, right. So we know that our algorithm is going to be like that. Okay? Now it makes no, you can assume that all the VIs are the same. Okay, so basically you want to maximize, so what you want to find is you want to find the set in A prime that has maximum intersection with this random set V. Okay? So, and Roberts will do this for you, but how good is it going to be for you? It's going to make you, do you, okay? And the answer is that unless A has some context, has enough, it's just one application of, we can do the calculation we want. It's one application of a Chernoff bound and one union bound. Okay, so you need to have that many sets. All right.
Why is A prime being large an indication of complexity?
Not yet. It's a lemma. Okay, that's where we're stuck for a long time.
Approximation of this. You're just saying if it achieves that value.
Right. If it achieves approximation.
No, this is an approximation. Okay, so
now. Okay. So the approximation, okay, approximation means it's a maximization problem, right?
Yeah.
So the approximation ratio is going to be this.
Approximation compared to the true value.
To the true value, which is going to be this. Half, yes, which is going to be this minus epsilon. The true value is, yeah, so basically what you want is you want to do two powers of m to the 2 epsilon better sort of, you know, than expectation. Okay? You want your maximum to be, yeah, and in order to do that you need you need slightly exponential.
The number of players here is huge.
The number, there is two things, okay? I know it's very confusing. There is one player. The resources are huge. Resources is M, your universe.
The resources is
M.
M.
Okay, there is one player, or if you wish, 1,000 players, but they all have the same.
Resources are where the subsets S are
coming. Right, are coming from. Okay. I believe it can be achieved essentially by doing something, by taking the best singleton. You know, there is a trivial. I believe, so you know, have to check it, that there is a trivial way to achieve it. Yes, you are allowed. But the point is, we want to find if there can be something which is truthful, polynomial, and good approximation. So we are looking for truthful now. Right. But then there is this argument of up there, which basically tells you that you might as well look for truthful. If anything non-truthful, I can make it into truthful.
Maybe painting a complex.
Right.
So this will mean that I can do no better by trying to approximate this problem using non-truthful.
Yes, you can do no better. Yeah, exactly. So basically, truthfulness
without
loss of generality. Yes, right. I know. It's a very, you know. But yen it's lost. Yes, I understand. Yeah, listen, I've been studying this problem for 15 years, and I have, you know, there is not a month in these 15 years that I didn't remind myself, oh yes, there is this argument. Yeah.
But this argument does not preserve complexity. So
look. If the arrows are polynomial, as they are in our case, it preserves complexity. There are cases where the arrows are not polynomial, and these have not been looked at.
So why are they polynomial in this case?
Because we assume that all, you know, as here, all our data is polynomial. Okay, we have succinctly describable functions, so every agent can show you can.
But the liar. Even the data may be polynomial, but maybe too
right, right, right. Too so the point is that if the original mechanism was, if I have to think exponential how to lie, of course the liars will have to be polynomial. Okay, so the assumption is if I could find out how to lie, how to best lie in polynomial time, then I might as well tell the truth. That's what this diagram shows. Listen, I agree that there is a lot of complex contemplation to be done there. Okay, so you know, and actually, you know, it should be forthcoming. I mean, it should be coming. All right. So now I have. Now I'm at a point where. Okay. Now what do I do? All right, I have established the following. First of all, lemma 1, very important. Lemma 1 implies lemma 2. if I want to have any decent approximation, any more than trivial approximation, I better have an exponential number of things. Now, where does this get me? Okay. How can I prove complexity? And the answer is quite simple. All right. So you know, and all of you know about it. I use the Sauer-Selah lemma. Okay. I know that I. You see what I'm saying? I know that I have an exponential number of, and I have to find the best among an exponential number of solutions. Okay. This number of solutions can have anything that have any structure they want, but the Sauer-Selah lemma tells me that there is a very well structured subset of these resources. Okay, and now I take advantage of this. Okay, so the theorem says. Unless NP equals P poly, and this is the non-constructive part due to the non-constructive nature of the Sauer-Selah lemma. Yes. There is a class. Thanks. There is a class. Did David say that? Okay, I thought so. Okay. there is a class of instances. Of CPPP with approximation. One minus epsilon. In other words, I can approximate. No problem if I don't care about truthfulness, but for which any truthful polynomial time mechanism cannot approximate. Better than this ratio. And the proof is by the Sauer-Selah lemma. Which says again, essentially, that if I have any such situation, in which case I have a large number m, wrong numbers, okay, an m by n matrix, okay, where there is m is exponential, let's say, then 0, 1 matrix, then there is a small subset, of course not contiguous, that has size at least n log m over log n that is shattered or combinatorial, okay, that all subsets all bit vectors exist there, okay. And now that I have found it, why did I have found it? Because my reduction can be non-constructive. Okay, can guess, can use advice. Since my advisor has given me this, I can embed an NP-complete problem here. All right, and you know I can show you the details, but that's the idea.
You embed, but you still have to be this function you use has to be some modulo.
Oh, absolutely, yes, right. I mean, actually, the function I use is as submodular as this. Essentially, I'm using this function.
So you restrict yourself to just this subset of the domain of the resources.
No, I don't. So basically, what happens is that. I start with an instance of this problem, right? Then I identify this subset here, right? Okay. Then I find such a then from this, I identified some function, not quite this. Okay, so let me. Amazing. There is only one eraser down there. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We, in Berkeley, we ask our undergraduates to get it. Okay. So here is the idea. The valuation, and again, imagine that everybody has the same valuation. The valuation is of the form VI of S is VI of let's call it, let's give it, of small s is the cardinality of the union okay, where these are some subsets of a new universe. So no, my valuation, I tell you how I'm going to evaluate every set, okay?
Yeah. So S is a set.
S is a small is a set in the small in the in the, in this in this universe, okay? All right. Now I have a bigger universe. And I say that that the valuation of a set of every set is the union of the cardinality of the union. All right, these are called coverage valuations. All right, and there are some modular.
You're not using V anymore.
Which V?
V was the way to get the lower bound for level.
Right. So we had to hit V, we had to hit it with that, right? I mean, also I'm not using V anymore. Okay, I'm using a new one. All right, and you know, is the lemma still true? Okay, you know. Many ways to look at it, okay? So, you know, for example, I say there exists, you know, so that's, you know, when I say a class of, you know, that includes everything I had to hit the mechanism with so far, okay? So, you know, I sort of accumulate all of these functions, all right? But they're still fine, okay? Because I can make all of these very approximate, eminently approximable, sort of, you know, by adding big constants to them and so on, okay? All right, so this is, okay? Some things that are going to come from the NP complete problem. Okay? The NP complete problem is set cover. All right? Yes, right. S is a subset of M. Okay? Sorry? Little s, yes, right, yeah. Little s is a subset. Yes, I mean, but even though this is general, yeah, yeah. And yes, the intention is that we're only going to use it for size k. All right, and the, so I shouldn't use s. Little t. Okay. And now, my s's are going to be some kind of these S's are going to be some kind of a set cover problem. This is for the come from a set cover problem. I'm giving a family of T1 through Tm, one for every and your question is, does there exist R sets such that R sets that they cover the universe. The universe is not, has nothing to do with the utilities, okay? It's a new set.
So this should be Ti capital Ti also?
No. This is the set cover pro instance I'm starting with, okay? Yeah. And now from this I'm going to create the S's, right? And basically the.
You want K sets?
Say?
Sorry, no.
I want M sets.
M.
Right?
No, but how many do you
R sets. So that's the original NP-complete problem, all right? Okay. And now what I'm doing is I'm mapping this to this problem, okay, as follows, new universe, okay, the new universe where universe prime is going to be the universe times 2, by times 2, either two disjoint sets, or if you wish, every time I intersect the universe, I get two brownie points instead of one, okay? Union M. Okay? And basically, I'm asking, is there a set of size K, okay, of size square root of M, does there exist little t okay, such that the cardinality of the union of the S I and little t equals to, it should be the whole universe times 2 plus k minus r. Okay, why k plus minus r? Because if I'm able to find in this little set here a set of r elements, so that if I go over here, they cover the whole universe, right? Then I would have k minus r more elements, because k is my budget. Sorry, I forgot to give you a, all right? And this means that these are covered by, again, the same Si is the same as Ti, except that there are two, and these are singletons. Can I take k minus r of these singletons to pad my solution, okay? So the structure of the optimum has to be r sets that cover twice the universe plus k minus r sets, singletons that pad it in an arbitrary way. And this shows that that it's NP-hard to optimize. But, well, I know we are not interested in optimization but approximation, but Robert says that 8 prime optimizes. Okay? And it's NP-complete to do that. So that's the end of the proof. Connections. I mean, I don't know which where to start. I mean, there are a few. There is an interesting aside, sort of, you know, that there is this technique has a small projection on complexity.
Can you do the punchline again? Why the approximation? Why it's okay to just?
So it's a long chain. Okay, right. Yeah. So Robert says that everything that is truthful. And we know that without loss of generality, we might as well assume it's truthful. Everything that is truthful has to be a affine maximizer. Okay? That's what these things are called, affine maximizers. Then we say, any affine maximizer for this stupid problem, the CPBB, has to have exponentially many sets. Then, if you have exponentially many sets, and we know it solves this problem exactly, then we can dig into these sets and find a combinatorial subset of the domain in which you can embed an NP-complete problem.
Exponentially many sets from lemma 2?
From lemma 2, yeah. Okay. Then, if we have from lemma 2, then I can find these guys, and now a reduction is enabled from an NP-complete problem. Okay? All the time, yes.
So in particular, for example, you need at least two players in the Robert theorem.
Right.
And then you forget about it.
They can have the same, you know.
Yeah, so I mean, maybe for this particular problem you use, Robert's theorem doesn't hold. I mean,
No. In the end, in the theorem, we have to take everything we used in the past. Okay. In other words, we have to say that the family of the class of instances of the CPPP, which for which you prove it, has to include everything we used in the past. Okay. Which means these instances here, the instances used in Robert's theorem, and so on. Okay. But it turns out that that's no problem. Sort of, you know, we know because first of all, the only thing is, are we sure that we can optimize all of this? And the answer is yes. Okay, sort of, you know, because we can approximate all of this. Because you can add huge constants to everything and nothing changes.
Isn't the problem of just solving the optimization problem for some modular function for one player?
Right, and be hard. It can be approximated.
It can be approximated.
One minus one over epsilon.
Right.
Yeah.
So this result, which I mean.
So that this is the contradistinction I'm bringing. This is why this theorem is interesting. Okay, that without truthfulness you can approximate. With truthfulness you cannot. If we insist on polynomial time. That's why this shows that as I put it here. APX intersect NP complete prime is not APX intersect NP complete, okay? Unless the polynomial hierarchy collapses. Do I make more sense?
So what is the algorithm achieving 1 minus E? It's not a mechanism
It's not a mechanism. Yeah. The algorithm is the greedy algorithm, it turns out. It's an algorithm due to Nemhauser. And others, but unfortunately. Right, and Woolsey, yes, right, and yeah, Nemhauser, Woolsey, yeah. But it's sort of, you know, it happened when I was in graduate school or something. Yeah, so, yeah. Okay, yeah. So basically, it shows what I was set out to do, and I don't know how to spend my last 20 minutes now. Okay, I want to show you one little thing, sort of like it has a tiny projection on complexity theory. Okay, so let's consider a language, okay, and call it dense if there exists an alpha such that for all n, does have to be for all n, for dense enough n, but let's forget it, I mean, also it can be made weaker, is at least, let's say, 2 to the alpha n. Okay, let's call this dense. And let's LSAT be the problem given, the LSAT is the problem given a truth assignment. Is there a satisfying truth assignment in L? Okay? So the same argument, it's exactly the same argument proves that LSAT is NP-hard. I'm sorry, is through non-constructive reductions. Okay? And okay, that's one thing. But for circuit SAT, there is a different neat reduction. How about L circuit SAT? Okay. And it turns out that here you can have a nice reduction. Okay, a much nicer reduction. Here is what it is. Imagine no, zero information about the complexity of L. Okay. So circuit SAT, you are given a little circuit here. Okay, with n bits. Okay. And you want to find if there is a way to make them, from L. All right. Okay? So, here is what you do. You start with a regular SAT, okay? A regular circuit SAT, okay? You are, you know, is there a way to find n bits that satisfy? And now you reduce it to a circuit SAT. And what you do is you make this n square or something, you know, whatever you need to, so that a universal hash function will map these enough of these circuits, of these bits, into so that they cover all of and now this is a circuit, call it C prime, which of course this is a randomized reduction, okay? So we know that this cannot be it's complete under randomized reductions. Incidentally, this can be made also true, this theorem can also be made true under randomized reductions because by using a result due to OITI, yes, right, yeah. A constructive, randomized constructive version of the Sauer-Cell lemma. Okay, I promised to tell you something about the Meyerson auction, and I think all I'll do is I'll give you a nice proof of Meyerson's theorem, okay? So that's instead of my result, okay? Okay, so here is what Meyerson's theorem is one of the greatest results in mechanism design. Here's the situation. You have bidders, agents, you, again, Chinese vase, okay? And, but you know their distributions, okay? You know their, you have a prior of their distribution, okay? You know basically, and it turns out that this enables you to find the optimum auction, the one that maximizes auctioneer revenue, okay? And I'm going to construct it for you.
In expectation,
yeah. So that maximizes expected auctioneer revenue. All right, so here is the idea. It turns out that anything, so we might as well say it's truthful, all right? I mean, so you have been used to me of saying this, all right? So it's truthful, it's going to be truthful. And the point is, in order for it to be truthful, it has to have, imagine that the valuations is between 0 and 1, okay? That you know. Okay, so here is a nice characterization that any auction like that, in order to be truthful, will have to be something like this. Okay, where this is 1, this is 2, okay? And basically, this is where 1 gets it, this is where 2 gets it, this is the valuation of 1, okay? This is the valuation of 2. Remember, we know the distributions here, okay? Here is where he gets it, here's where he gets it, and here nobody gets it. And the amazing thing is that there have to be these regions where nobody gets it, and immediately you know it's not, does not optimize social welfare, okay? Because if we are to optimize social welfare, somebody should get it at all points, all right? And the whole thing about this function is that this should be A, a function of Y, and this should be beta, a function of X, okay, alpha and beta. In other words, there has to be a function. In other words, this region has to be rightward closed, and this region has to be upward closed. This means essentially the following, okay? That if you get it at this point and you bid more, you still get it, okay? And this thing is how much you pay, okay? The left end of the boundary says, listen, that's for truthfulness, right? Tell me your truth and you're going to pay this. So the thing is the following, all right? Any such auction will have the following structure. give me your bid, you give me your bid, you give me your bid, oops, go away. Okay? Or you get it and you pay this. We want to optimize the income of the auctioneer. Okay?
So if nobody gets it, that means
he gets zero, but he gets zero.
He doesn't,
imagine that this is, don't think of it as a Chinese vase where you can sell in 2 weeks. Yeah. Think of it as an ad word, okay? So you know, either somebody gets it now or I'd get nothing, all right? So or if you wish, the auctioneer's retail, you know, retaining value has been calculated here. Okay, so you know, so this is I get zero here. But if I didn't get zero, you see what happens? That this would have to go here, and therefore this guy here would have to pay me much less. And I don't want to lose this. Okay, that's why it's to my advantage to create these zeros here. Okay, it's to the auctioneer's advantage to create these zeros. Okay. All right, so that's the general structure of this code. And now comes the key observation. Imagine that these are independent, okay? So this is the general case for correlated distributions. And in fact, that's the case we are examining in our work, okay? And we prove that for two bidders, it's polynomial, and for three bidders, it's empty, hard to approximate, okay? But imagine that this is now uncorrelated, all right? What can you say? You can say a few more things. You can say the following. What is this golf business here, right? Okay, in other words, you will never have, you know, this is going to be a monotone function. Alpha is going to be a monotone function of y, all right? Why is that? Because why do you have this rule that this guy dips into the zero area here and not a little lower, okay? Why do you interfere? Why do you want this to happen here when this guy has a higher valuation and not a little lower, where there will be less in the feet of each other? So I'm just waving my hands now, sort of, you know, but it's a very common sense thing, right? I mean, you know, since they are independent, this is the wrong dependence on this guy, okay? So, you know, because this distribution is the same as this distribution, as this distribution, as this distribution, as this distribution, okay? It's this one. Why do you have this bump high as opposed to low? Okay, so basically what it says, it pushes these things down, okay? You don't have bumps. Then it says, nobody gets it here. Are you sure? Somebody got it here. Why now nobody gets it, okay? Or somebody got it here. Why now nobody gets it, okay? One of them should get it. So these things make no sense anymore, okay? Oops, this thing might still make sense because this argument, okay, cannot hold in the beginning, all right? I mean, it needs some curve here to make this argument. And if there is no curve here or there, so there may be still a rectangle here. So all I'm saying is that what this truly elementary argument proves is that, and I only did it for two bidders because you only gave me a two-dimensional blackboard. Okay, right. So, but I mean, it's the same for. Okay. So there is going to be another than that. There's going to be a dividing line like that. That's it. Okay, and if they have the same valuation, then you know it's going to be a square and a straight line, and you just have to do your calculus to find out what's the best reserve price. That's going to be a reserve price, right? Here, you have to be as clever as Meyerson to calculate what this you know. The amazing thing is that this says that you reduce to Vickrey auctions with the reserve price. Okay, so basically it says, from this, calculate a virtual price In fact, what's the voice of edge over ice? From V, you go to V prime, which is V minus, I always forget it. Times, sorry, 1 minus F of V divided by F of V. These are the distributions, okay? The cumulative and the density.
This is a function,
right? The cumulative the distribution and the, you know. So this formula, in fact, this may not be always monotone, so you need to do something that Meyerson calls ironing, and you monotone close it, okay? You make it monotone. And that's sort of, you know, that's the whole sophistication is in this operator here. So, you know, it's a very delicate argument, very sophisticated, delicate argument. But the point is that this tells you, go to a different space, okay, where you transform this into this function, and now you have just Vickrey auction, okay? And these people read the rules and realize that the transformation is such that I have to behave like in a Vickrey auction, because otherwise I'm cheating myself, okay? And the reserve price will be the value where this hits zero, okay? So you do Vickrey auction, and if your price is negative, you don't even bid. So it's an ingenious, if you wish, the reduction from this more general problem to the problem of Vickrey auctions. And I gave you the proof, except for this calculation, which you really cannot get it more easier, I think, than with the way Meyerson did. So the dependence gives us that these two curves are monotone, and also that there are no empty spaces except in the very beginning.
That there are no empty spaces doesn't follow just after monotone. I mean, once they are monotone.
Yes. Yes. You cannot have empty spaces either. Yeah. Oh, I see. Right. Yes. So if the things are monotone, I think that you can always write. Yeah. You're right. Okay. I don't know if you can get something new out of that. Have to think about it. Okay. So maybe I have enough time to tell you just the. I think I'll tell you our theorem. So our theorem says the following. That. How do you do the general, the correlated what you do is you create two functions, F and G. You have a joint distribution of players. Use this joint distribution, I can write you the formula. You create two functions, F and G. F is for every point here, F is what is the marginal, the incremental benefit to the auctioneer, expected benefit to the auctioneer, if this point is assigned to this guy. And G is to bidder one. And G is what is this if it's assigned to bidder two. It's a function that of the for every point of the unit on the unit square. Yeah. It's a real function, positive real function of the unit square. It's calculated from the distribution only.
Oh.
Simple formula. So it has integrals and so on.
No. So what did you say? It's calculated from the distribution and the meaning of it.
The meaning is it. Suppose that I decide that this point goes to this guy. In other words, if
you give it to the first player.
To the first player, yes, right, yeah. How much would the, what is the incremental benefit to the auctioneer in expectation?
Incremental compared to what?
As if this was given to the other guy or to nobody.
So then these are negative?
No, they're different. So you're right. I mean, because of the intricacies of phi of the joint distribution, there could be many different Okay, so basically what you have is this f and g. And basically what you want is you want to find these functions, alpha and beta, okay, that you compute the soup of some integrals of f and g, okay? Are these curves? Yes, exactly. They are the curves that I had, you know, they're alpha y and beta of x. You know, they have to be functions, okay? And you want to find. And then you have something else. Imagine now that you look at this as a landscape in your garden, okay? Okay, and your garden has this shape, and you want to transform it into this shape. So it's a little like Mons Kantorovich, okay? So except that distances don't get into the play. And you want to transform this landscape into this landscape, doing the least possible work, okay? And what is work? Three kinds: throw away, remove mass, add mass. So mass is thrown away, mass materializes here, or move mass to the southeast. In other words, the only thing I can do is take a little of this mass and move it as far as I want to the southeast, okay? And these are the only three operations. And you want to find this transportation schedule that minimizes these mass transfers, okay? And the theorem says that these two are the same. That, in other words, there is a duality theorem, all right? That this is the same as this, okay? That to do this, to find this, is the same as doing this. And, okay, we can prove it, but I can show you the really very basic, simple, like this simple combinatorial fact that lies under it, okay? It's something that everybody will recognize in 1 minute, okay?
So move mass depends on the distance.
No. To move it here, how much mass is moved. And moving includes leaving it there. That's a move. That's a move zero distance to the southeast, okay? So here is the combinatorial trick that underlies it. Okay, what do I have? I have this thing. Okay, that maybe I want to give this to this guy. Maybe I want to go give this to this guy. All right, but I cannot do both here. This means that I have a graph, and I want to find a weighted independent set in this graph, because there are some things that I cannot do both of. Right? Hello, this graph is bipartite because it's two-dimensional. And if I go to three dimensions, it becomes tripartite, and that's why it's MB-Hard. End of story.
And that's all the combinatorial condition you need.
Yes. You need a couple of other things that turn out magically or trivially, sort of, you know, to be implied by this. So at optimality, to be always right.
Well, this is some extension of Koenig's theorem.
Koenig's.
What the duality you use for independent sets in bipartite
graph. Oh, I see. You can do it many ways. So the way we did it is by lots of inequalities. So we discretize, we've proved the duality in the discrete, and then bound.
But the duality in the discrete is the same duality.
Is this, yes, right, yeah. And yes, Koenig's theory, right, yeah. And then I thought if we use the Banach, whatever it's called. No, we are using elementary, yeah. You know, infinite dimensional duality, I thought you meant. Okay, right. No, no. Okay, yes. So you use this. I mean, you know, the duality between transportation and independent set. I guess, yes, right, yeah.
Okay.
All right, thanks. Cool. All right, sure.